Hi, GCN grads. Wherever you go next, remember Deuteronomy 31:8. The Lord himself will go before you and be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. We're so proud of you. Love you.
Congratulations to the 2020 graduating seniors from GCN. I want to give a special shout out to the graduating seniors from our quiz team. It has been a pleasure and a blessing to watch you guys dig into the Word and grow through the years. And I just wish you all the best of luck, and God bless you all as you venture into this new chapter of your lives. Bye-bye.
Hi, GCN seniors. This is Laurelie and Greg, and we just wanted to tell you how proud we are of you. We've known most of you since you were little kids, and it surely has been a joy to watch you grow up.
We know it wasn't the senior year you expected, but we know that there are great things ahead for you, and we just know that you have a lot of skills and gifts and talents, and we hope that you use those to serve God and to serve others. Congratulations.
Hi, everyone. I just want to say congratulations to all of those who are graduating. I know it's been a rough couple of weeks for everyone. It's not the way you guys wanted the year to end, but you guys pulled through. Just remember to always keep your head up, never give up, and we love you guys. See ya.
Congrats, class of 2020. Bowser and I want to say we're so proud of you, and we're so happy that you graduated. Congrats! Yeah!
Hey, seniors. Just wanted to chime in and say congrats on graduating in these crazy times. I know it must be wild, but we're all really proud of you. We're sad to see you go, but so excited for what the next chapter of life is going to look like. So hopefully we'll get to celebrate properly with you guys soon. But until then, stay safe and congrats again.
Hey, graduates. We are so proud of you for all the hard work you've done to get to this moment. And we're just excited for you for what comes next. Love you guys.
Congratulations, class of 2020. Thank you for bringing so much joy to me and everybody else that you came in contact with. And I wish you the best. Can't wait to see what God has in store for you.
Hi, GCN, class of 2020. I just wanted to congratulate you for your accomplishments. Graduating from high school is such a big deal. It's a huge turning point in your life, and we're really proud of you. I've known a lot of you since you were born, and it's an honor and privilege to watch you to grow up and to be there with you. And for those of you who I've just met in the youth group these past couple years, you are such a part of my life and my heart, and I am just really proud of all of you guys. I'd just like to share with you my favorite verse, and it helps me through all the times of my life. Even through the disappointments and the struggles and the unknown. It's Isaiah 54:10. Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. So just remember that, and God will guide your steps. Congratulations, you guys! Woo! Class of 2020!
Hey guys, congratulations to the class of 2020. Best wishes for all of you. Keep on doing amazing things. Here's my favorite verse from 2 Chronicles 15:7, which says, "That is for you, be strong and do not give up, for your work will be rewarded." Love you guys.
Congratulations, graduates. In this time of excitement and change, I pray that you remember that you are loved immensely and that God is faithful and will be with you through everything.
Congratulations, graduates. So proud of each and every one of you. Looking forward to seeing what God is going to do in your lives in these upcoming days. Blessings to each and every one of you. Bye.
Good morning, and welcome to the Gaithersburg Church of the Nazarene and our online worship service. Thanks so much for tuning in and joining us on this final Sunday of May. If you're new with us or have anything to communicate, we invite you to fill out an online welcome card. You can go to the Gaithersburg Church of the Nazarene website, click on the Connect tab, and there you'll find the the welcome card. Thanks for filling it out, and we look forward to connecting with you this week. A big thank you to everybody who donated and or delivered school supplies and food this past week to 109 families. The families are from the Fox Chapel Elementary School. Thanks so much for your generosity and for being God's presence out in our community. Well, today is GCN Grad Sunday. It's an annual tradition, and we send our congratulations to all graduates, high school, college, master's degree, all of it. We celebrate this achievement with you. And coming up a little later in our service this morning, a special tribute to our high school graduates. Again, congratulations to you all. We have found some pretty unique ways to stay connected during this pandemic, and we have another opportunity for you this week. We're calling it GCN Spirit Week. As you can see, there are different ways you can show your spirit each day this coming week. What do you do? Take a picture of yourself completing the task and post it on social media with the hashtag that you see there. All the details are on the GCN Facebook page and will be in the emails from the church this week. Special thanks to Sarah Abod for organizing all of this. It sounds like a lot of fun. Now, before our kids' message this morning, this reminder for children and their families. Vacation Bible School is happening at GCN this summer. It has gone completely online. It'll take place June 22nd through the 25th online at 6:30 each evening. This is a live, interactive, fun event. It'll happen on the GCN YouTube and Facebook pages. But we still need you to register, so please go to the GCN website, click on Vacation Bible School, and register. We sure hope you can join us. And thank you for joining us for our worship service this morning.
Hey kids and church family. Do you ever open up the Bible, read a passage, and not quite understand? Well, it happens to me. Sometimes I think, what in the world is this talking about? And it can be hard to ask questions because we're worried that it might seem silly or that there might be an obvious answer or that it's something people might think we should already know. Our story today is about a guy who had some questions and he was determined to have them answered so he could learn more about God. The story fits right in with our celebration of Pentecost because it takes place during the time of the early church. And you can find it a few chapters after the story of Pentecost in the book of Acts, chapter 8, verses 26 to 40. The story starts off with a guy called Philip. He's an early Christ follower and he even got picked by the church to have a special position. Philip is doing his thing when, all of a sudden, an angel appears and says to him, "Start walking that away." So he gets on the road and starts heading that away when he runs into an Ethiopian guy. This guy is a very important guy who is in charge of all the money that belongs to Candace, queen of the Ethiopians. Now, this Ethiopian guy had just come from worshiping in Jerusalem, and he's headed back home, and as he's riding along in his chariot, he's reading the book of Isaiah. And at this point, the Holy Spirit kind of gives Philip a little nudge and says, "This is the guy you're supposed to talk to. Go hang around by his chariot and see what's going on." So Philip goes over and hears the guy reading scripture, and he says, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And the guy responds, "How can I, unless someone explains it to me?" So he asks Philip to hop on in and join him in the chariot. As they're rolling along, they take a look at this particular part of scripture, and it's talking about someone who's called the Lamb, and someone who's, this person is treated very unfairly, and this person is eventually killed. Maybe you can guess who this scripture is talking about. But the Ethiopian guy did not have a clue. So he says to Philip, "Is Isaiah talking about himself in this passage, or is it someone else?" And this gives Philip the perfect opportunity to tell the guy all about the good news of Jesus, how he died for us and rose again, and how much he loves us. And the guy was so excited, he said, "Hey, we've got some water over there.
why don't I get baptized? He ordered them to stop the chariot, and then they both hopped down and went into the water. When they came back up, since Philip had just finished what the Holy Spirit had brought him there to do, the Spirit took him away and he disappeared just like that. As weird as that seems, the Ethiopian guy was so happy to learn about Jesus and to be baptized that he barely even noticed that Philip disappeared and went on his way dancing and celebrating and having a party. Here's that verse from Galatians that we heard about earlier this month when Jen was building her tower. It's from the book of Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Let us not become tired of doing good. At the right time, we will gather a crop if we don't give up. I'm thinking that since the Ethiopian guy was pretty important, it must have been tough for him to ask questions, because if someone's in charge of a lot of stuff, we usually think they know a lot of stuff. And that can make it hard for them to admit things they don't know because they don't want their questions to change our opinion of them. But if such an important guy can put all that aside and ask Philip his questions about the things he didn't quite get, that shows us that it's even more important than we might think for us to be able to ask questions. Now, this doesn't mean badger your parents, because I know we're all at home together these days and there's certainly a time for everything. But it means when you have questions about God, don't just let them go. Stick with it, because the more we know about God, the better we can understand how much God loves us and the kind of person God wants us to be in our everyday life. I love you guys, and I hope you have a wonderful week.
Good morning, GCN family. We're glad you're joining us for worship.
A lot has changed over the past few months, but we know God's love never changes.
A lot of important events have been canceled, and it's disappointing, but we know that God's grace is never canceled, and His mercy is never disappointing.
This morning is Grad Sunday. We, the class of 2020, are thankful for a church who honors its graduates. We feel your love.
But this morning is also Pentecost Sunday. This is the day that we celebrate the presence of Jesus coming so close to us that His Spirit actually fills us.
So this morning, we pray that you sense God's Spirit very near to you.
And we pray that our worship service of Jesus will shape us into people who look more like Jesus in our world.
So GCN family, let's join together and worship Jesus Christ, the Holy One.
Stay. For years, we have deliberately made the graduate honoring a part of our worship service. And we do that because we believe that this rite of passage that these seniors in high school are taking is so significant that we want our whole church family to be a part of it. And I'll be honest, I was struggling this year to figure out just the right way to adequately honor our graduates, because like so many other things in life, whether it's a birthday party or a grad party or anything else, it's just not the same when we're not together, right? So this message is to each of our 14 high school graduates, to Katie Blenderman, Claire Bradshaw, Joe Bunker, Rondell Carlton, Maria Fernandez, Crystal Flores, Quasi Hill, Jordan Holland, Crystal Flores, already said you, Sarah Mathis, Isaiah Morris, Jeremy Neal, Lisa Ross, Nathan Stein, and Grace Viagbo. Whew, I got them all, one twice. This message is to you. You can't visibly see your whole church family gathered around you right now like we typically would on a grad Sunday, but maybe you can see in your comments on this video right now and see the love and support that you have from your church family. Now, ordinarily, obviously, we'd be gathered in the sanctuary together, and this right here would be my favorite part of any grad Sunday, and honestly, one of my favorite moments of a worship service all year is this right here. It's when we call all of our graduates and their families up to the platform. There's about 14 grads, so we might have 50 or so people gathered up there. And I would ask you, graduates and families, to look out on the sanctuary, on the congregation, and see all those faces. And I would remind you that for many of you graduates, it was only 17 or 18 short years ago that you and your parents were up again at the front of the church. And again, Pastor Ben would have asked you to look out on the congregation and see your church family before you as you were dedicated as a little baby to the church and to Jesus Christ. And as you would look out once again, maybe you can visualize it even now, I would tell you this. The same God who was faithful to you and who was guiding your steps, drawing you unto himself, even as a little baby, that same God is faithful now and is with you now as you enter this next phase of your journey. And that same church family who committed to sticking with you, to praying for you, to helping guide your steps, is still committing the same thing even right now in this moment, 17, 18 years later, as you enter this next step, this next phase of your journey. Graduates, you are loved. You are prayed for. We are proud of you. And we hope you sense that and feel that this morning. We love you guys.
We'd hear cries. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, oh, then in longing rapture, hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Oh, be lifted high, Jesus. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
Stand strong and worship you, and if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice 'cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings, I'll hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. 'Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing.
Congratulations to our graduates. We are
We're going to take some time to pray, especially for our graduates this morning. If you're watching this service with somebody who's graduating or graduated this year, you might want to lay your hand on their shoulder or just let them know that you're praying especially for them during this time. Father, we lift up our graduates today. We celebrate with them in this accomplishment. We celebrate the hard work and the stamina that has brought them here. We know that they've not done this alone. We thank you for those who have partnered with them along the way, those who have encouraged them, guided them, challenged them, and loved them. Lord, we thank you for them.
Eternal Father, we come before your presence. We lift up our graduates and we celebrate with them this accomplishment. We celebrate their hard work and dedication throughout this time. We know that you have been there with them all along. We also thank those who encouraged them, who guided them, who challenged them, and who loved them throughout this time. We know that they have accomplished this during challenging times, with activities that were mostly online and with special arrangements. Lord, we ask you to bring comfort to those who are grieving the losses of loved ones and dear friends.
Lord, we pray each of these students will stay connected. Connected to others who will be encouraging to them, connected to a church, connected to you. May they stay connected to the church. Lead them to a good church community and friends who are also grounded in their relationship with you, whether that is here at GCN or in the places where they are at school or work. Lord, we pray that each of these students will be filled with a desire to know you and to remain in you, to live and grow in relationship with you. May they yearn to spend time in prayer and reading your word.
Graduation signals heading into a new phase of life. This can feel like heading into things unknown. As we take these steps, we know that you go before us. Lord, direct their paths. Give them wisdom beyond their years. Give them courage as they begin college or jobs. We pray a hedge of protection as they take these steps. Remind them of all they have learned so far, and continue to fill them with wisdom and knowledge along the way. May they be filled with compassion and be light to those around them as they prepare to step into this next phase of life. May these students be stronger and courageous.
Over all of that, Lord, we pray for each of these students that they would know how long and how wide and how high and how deep and how sure and how steady and how everlasting the love of Christ is, and that he loves them, that he loves each of us with that everlasting love. Lord, we thank you for all of the ways that you have been with us this week and all of the ways that you will be with us in the week to come. Lord, those who are sick, we ask that you would lay a hand of healing upon them. Those who are going through transitions, we ask that you would be with them, bring them peace and comfort. For those who are going through uncertain times, be with them. May they know that they are not alone in this uncertainty. You are with them. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for all of the ways that you love us, all of the ways that you show your love for each of us. Lord, we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Great job, Crystal and Lisa. You guys always sound great. And I think you could tell it through the screen there, friends. They meant what they were singing. And I'm just really proud of all of our graduates, all of our seniors, top to bottom, all 14 of them. There's not a bad one in a bunch, man. They are some good, good kids. And let's be praying for them, continue to pray for them. So, couple months ago, it was actually about the 1st of March, almost 3 months ago now, feels like 2 years ago, right? Before all this began, I was on a phone conversation with my mom, and she was telling me that she read somewhere on an article that churches should start thinking about what to do in case of going completely online, all worship services online, because it was beginning to look like that this coronavirus scare might be more serious than what some are thinking. Now, I'm going to admit to you, I dismissed her pretty quickly. I said, yeah, right. I mean, what are we going to cancel schools too? Are they going to shut down all major sporting events and all gatherings everywhere? They're going to cancel church services. I kind of dismissed her. And so first lesson here, kids, is do not be dismissing your mom so quickly. Sorry about that, Mom. I was wrong. And just like a tsunami wave that is just far enough offshore that you can't quite see it yet, I had no idea what kind of disruption was about to hit. Many of you were in the same boat. We had no clue what was coming. And so here we are 3 months later, and all of a sudden I'm preaching to you from the middle of a high school parking lot. I had a phone conversation just this past week in which we talked about different face mask designs, right? Stuff that I would have never thought about just a few months ago. So things got weird pretty quickly. And on this grad Sunday, I'm thinking about our grads. A lot of things could describe what these past few months have looked like, but I want to go with that word that we used just a minute ago, disruption. A lot of things for our graduates, especially all of us, have been disrupted. And many of us who are a few years removed from our high school years can empathize with you high school seniors. Think about it. No in-person school for the past 3 months. So many things have been canceled. Canceled proms, canceled graduation ceremonies. No last week of school with friends and teachers and all the other fun things that go along with that. It's all been disrupted. And then, of course, there's the disruption for everyone else, the disruption to people's steady source of income, the disruption to the security about our own health and physical well-being. So you get it. We all know. We're in the same boat here. That's the context. So do something with me. Let's carry all that, all those thoughts about disruption and frustrations and chaos and fear and change plans, carry all that with you, and let's enter, listen to the story for today on this Pentecost Sunday, the story from Acts chapter 2. And we've got some friends, some high school seniors, some graduates who are going to be reading our scripture for this morning.
Today's scripture reading is from Acts chapter 2, starting in verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting.
They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them.
Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken.
In that same chapter, Peter is at the end of his message to the huge crowd he had gathered, and he says this, "Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this, God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?"
Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. This is the word of the Lord.
Yes, thanks be to God. So today is Pentecost Sunday. It's the day in the life of the church when we celebrate God's Holy Spirit being poured out and filling, empowering those believers in the upper room gathered on that first Pentecost. The church was born on Pentecost. This is the birthday of the church. And Pentecost is actually a Jewish holy day. Another name for this day, Pentecost, is Shavuot. Pentecost comes 50 days after Passover, which means it comes 50 days after Good Friday, 7 weeks after Easter. And the whole purpose of the festival of Shavuot, of Pentecost, is to remember and to celebrate the giving of God's law to Moses and the Israelites. And many of you are probably familiar with that Old Testament story. Even if you're not familiar with that story, you've probably seen the movie at some point. It's that story where Moses, he climbs up Mount Sinai and there's this great wind and lightning, and it looks like the mountain is engulfed in tongues of fire. And God meets with Moses, and Moses is God's great representative, and God meets with him on that mountain, and God inscribes his law so that Moses could take it down from the mountain and show God's people what their lives are supposed to look like. Now, the problem is that when Moses comes down the mountain, he finds out that the Israelites got so impatient with Moses being gone that they decide to completely turn away from God, and they build this golden calf. And they started worshiping this calf, just completely disobedient. So when Moses sees their disobedience, he tells the tribe of Levi, the priestly tribe, to go through the whole camp of those Israelites and to destroy anyone who has been disobedient. 3,000 people were killed that day. 3,000 died because of their disobedience. So now, here we are in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost, the day that celebrates the giving of the law to Moses. And it's not Moses, but it's 120 believers who are present. And they aren't up on a mountain, but they're in the upper room. And a great wind comes from heaven and starts filling that house, and tongues of fire come down on them. And this image sounds kind of familiar, right? And they're filled with the Holy Spirit. God's very presence is now inside of them, empowering them, giving them great boldness. And then Peter and all those believers, all 120, they come down from that upper room, and Peter looks up out at the crowd, and filled with the Holy Spirit, he begins to preach to them. He talks about the good news of Jesus Christ. And it says that those people, those disbelieving, disobedient people, were cut to the heart, and they began to repent of their wrongdoing, and they received forgiveness, and they received the Holy Spirit. And then, instead of 3,000 people, disobedient people, losing their lives that day, it says that 3,000 people were added to their number that day. And when we look at these two stories side by side, it becomes very clear that God is now up to something new. There is something very different going on here now. God's very Spirit, His Holy Spirit, is not just meeting with a man on a mountain, but He's now filling the lives of those believers. And they don't stay huddled in that upper room, but they bust out of that room into a city filled with disobedient people, and the result is not subtraction. 3,000 people didn't die. Instead, the result is multiplication. 3,000 people are saved. And God's Spirit, friends, is now on the loose. It started in Pentecost. His Spirit filled His people, and it's not stopped since. And when you read the book of Acts, you can see it. It's amazing at first. The first three chapters is amazing. More and more people are finding their life in Christ, added to their number daily. They're sharing all that they have. They're having meals together. They're helping those in need. There's blind beggars that are being healed in the name of Jesus. People filled with the Holy Spirit are healing people. And that lasts for about 2.5 chapters, about a minute, right? And then people are being thrown into prison. Someone is being stoned to death. There's disagreement between the disciples. The government is against them. There's snake bites and shipwrecks, and it's disruption after disruption and fear and chaos, and it's a mess. And at every turn in that early church, there are these moments where it seems like it might just all crumble. There's just too much stuff working against them. But over and over and over again, we see God's Holy Spirit intimately guiding the church, and the church thrives and flourishes. We see God's Spirit empowering those believers. And it's just kind of crazy, the boldness that those believers had. It's almost like they weren't even trying to do it in their own power. It's almost like the more obvious it was that they were not in control, but the Holy Spirit was driving this whole thing, then the more empowered and joy-filled they became, the more the church grew and flourished. When those Holy Spirit-filled believers were thrown into prison, they started rejoicing and becoming even bolder in spreading the good news. These people were leading the jailers to Jesus. Public stonings became the events, the catalyst that spread the good news of Jesus Christ even further. It was just getting out of hand with this early church. Now, back to right now, 2020. COVID-19, this global pandemic, is highly disruptive. And we grieve what's been lost. If the book of Acts was still being written today, if they just kept on going after chapter 28, we'd be on about chapter, 150, 200 by now. And I bet COVID-19 would make the pages of the book of Acts. You know, it would say, global pandemic spreads great fear and upheaval all across the world. But the main subject of the story in the book of Acts, if it was still being written, would not be the global pandemic. Just like the main point, the main subject of those stories back then were not the shipwrecks or the prison or the stonings or even death, but the main subject, the main purpose of it all was always God. He was always the main character. And this powerful movement of God's Holy Spirit. So the question that drove them back then, and the question that must drive us today, is this: what is God up to in the middle of all of this? Because remember, God does not cause disruption or chaos. God, by His Holy Spirit, though, has this rich history of redeeming what appears to be setbacks and doing something new, of continuing to build His church. If you were tuning in with us last week, some of what I'm saying right now might sound vaguely familiar to what Pastor Ben was saying. Somehow, by God's providence, God was laying similar messages on each of our hearts separately, and I'm taking all that as a sign that this is the message of God for the people of God, GCN, right now. And I can't recall any time in recent history when we as a society, even as individuals, have been more keenly aware of the reality that we ultimately have very little control over what's going on. There's just so much that we don't know right now, right? Think about it. We don't know the economic toll of all of this. We don't know when a cure or a vaccine will come available. We don't know what school is going to look like in the fall. We don't know how all of this is shaping us as a culture, as people, differently. So much that we don't know, and so little that we have control of. And sin, at its heart, tries to convince us that we are in control. But what if God, by His Spirit, is using a disruption to be the thing that wakes up His church? And for us to realize that we never had the control that we thought we had in the first place. And to realize that our only hope is complete dependence upon and obedience to God and His Holy Spirit. And church, what if In the midst of all this, all that's going on right now, God's Holy Spirit is using a disruption to model for us, remind us that from its very beginning, the church has never been a place we just go to. The church has never been a place that we just attend, but the church has always been a people that we belong to, a family that we are a part of, and a mission that we are sent on together. That's what the church is. Pastor Ben last week said this phrase. He said, "I don't want to get back to normal." And I don't either. I would agree with that. Because the things that have become normal is the very thing that I want to be rescued from. I long for us, church, to be rescued from our complacency. I want us to be delivered from any mindset that prioritizes personal preference over the mission of God in the world and the work that He's doing in our midst. I want anything but normal. Because there is nothing normal about a God who both rules over everything and yet is intimately accessible to you and me right now. There is nothing normal about a God who reaches down and offers His grace and salvation to you and me through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And there is nothing normal about a God who sends His very Spirit to intimately guide and comfort and empower us. So no, the last thing we need is normal. And what we need is God's presence. Think about those apostles, those early believers in the book of Acts. What was their secret, you know? They were just regular women and men. Did they have any access to anything that we do not have access to? So what compelled that early church to just keep pressing on and keep going and even rejoicing and being bold in the midst of whatever setback and disruption and chaos came their way? What caused those early believers to have such laser focus on Jesus and His mission in the world no matter what happened? It's not a secret. It's this, friends. It's a complete surrender of their life to the way of Jesus Christ and allowing God's presence to fill them. That is what we need, GCN. I want us to be a church filled with women and men who say, "I want to surrender my life, my whole way, to the way of Jesus Christ, and I want to open myself up to be filled with His presence, His very Spirit." GCN family, that is the only way for the church to be the church, is by His Holy Spirit in us, guiding this whole thing, empowering it. That's been the case from the beginning, and it's the case right now. Maybe God is using this to show us that. I'm thinking about our graduates this morning, or any of our young people. Your upcoming fall semester might be looking a lot different than what you thought it was going to look a few months ago. Your senior year, these last 3 months, have looked far different than what you could have dreamed when you started out this year. And everything you might feel is disruption. You might feel like disruption is all around you. But what if that disruption that the enemy meant for harm, seniors, young people, is actually a gift by God's Spirit that is being used to shake you awake? Because we need you, young people. What if God is using this time to call you to Himself? You could, right now in this moment, say, "Man, I want to surrender my whole life, my whole future, to the way of Jesus Christ. I have been thinking about what I want to do, but no more. I want to say, God, whatever you want me to do, I want to be on your mission now. I want to be filled with your Spirit, your very presence." And that's not just for our graduates this morning. That's for everyone. That invitation is for all of us. Look at your life right now. Ask God to examine what's going on inside of you. ask the question, do you need to surrender your life to the way of Christ? Have other things become more precious to you than the presence of God and His mission in this world? Are you feeling weak today? Are you feeling anxious or uncertain? Jesus Christ, by His very Spirit, can meet with you right now, right where you're sitting, just like He did 2,000 years ago in that upper room. He can fill your life right now. I don't want to rush past this moment. We're in different spaces right now. I'm in a school parking lot. You might be in your home or somewhere else. But God's Holy Spirit is very powerful. It transcends time. It can move past boundaries. And I'm convinced that God's presence is even working through a live stream, through a video. God's presence is right here. Would you pray, God, Spirit of the living God, fall on me. I need you. Would you receive His presence today?
Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice. We're hanging
Let's pray together. God, we need you. We need your Spirit to guide us, to give us your power, your boldness, to comfort us. God, I pray that you would help us to live not by our own strength, but by your strength. Help us not to become so conformed to the ways of this world, but help us to be transformed as your Spirit renews our mind. God, we want to be a part of your mission. We don't want to just do church, we want to be the church. God, we pray for our young people this morning, our graduates. I pray, God, that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit. May they be transformed into young women and men who go forth sharing the good news about your kingdom of God and the difference that you can make in this world in big and small ways, that they would be just driven by that, God. But we don't just pray that that would be the case for them. God, may that be the case for all of us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for your mercy. And thank you for your transforming work. Fill us now, Lord, and send us out. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Friends, receive this word of blessing, this benediction. We are being sent out right now. Just like those apostles gathered in that upper room did not stay crowded together, 120 of them in that upper room, but they oozed out. And I know times are a little different for us right now, but there is nothing about the character of the Holy Spirit that stays closed off, but it's always opening up and it's always sent out. So receive these words of blessing on this Pentecost Sunday. May you receive the grace of God in your life. May the forgiving power of Jesus by his death and resurrection be at work renewing you. And may you be filled with God's Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit that gives you strength and power and comfort, and it will guide you and guide his church. May we be filled with his Spirit. And now from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May he fill you with his Holy Spirit through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus. The one who calls you is so, so faithful, and he will do it. I love you, friends. Stay connected. Go in peace.